Hey everybody, welcome back to Up the Vibe, and today I have the great pleasure of talking to Jim Penniston, together with fellow contributor James Rose. Jim Penniston has now retired from USAF Special Forces, where he wrote defence, security, counter-terrorism and contingency plans for the USAF and NATO. Sergeant Penniston and his team were first responders to a security investigation of a craft of unknown origin, located just outside RAF Woodbridge in England. In December 1980, this case is known as the Rendlesham Forest Incident and is one of the most documented accounts in military history. Jim is a frequent lecturer and presenter at numerous MUFON events and a speaker at two national press club events. His first responder's account of the Rendlesham Forest Incident has been featured worldwide on numerous television and radio programs. And in addition, Jim has been a contributor to other books concerning this phenomenon, including the Rendlesham Enigma, which I highly recommend. Hi, Jim, how are you? And thank you for being on the podcast.
Doing great. Thanks for having me on. Appreciate it.
Yeah, it's a pleasure to meet you, Jim. And we're really honored that you give us your time.
Yeah.
No, I'm actually excited to hear new questions. I would love to have new questions.
That's good. Well, thank you so much for being on. I wonder if before we start into the questions, I wonder if you could introduce yourself a bit more, talk a bit about your background leading up to becoming Staff Sergeant at Bentwaters.
Oh, well, that's a different question, yes.
In brief.
Yeah. Briefly, I entered the Air Force in 73. The stuff that sets me aside, I think, prior to that, is that within 10 months of being in the service in 74, I received my top secret clearance. And I held that, for the other remaining 20 years I was in. Mm-hmm. I've been to three, four other bases prior to going there. At Bentwaters. I did have another tour of duty early in 75 at RAF Elkenbury. That's over by Cambridge, in case you guys don't know where that's at. It's probably closed. they're all closings. Yeah. I don't think there's many open anymore. Maybe Lakenheath is still open and Mildenhall maybe. But that's about it. And so I worked the missile field in Montana prior to going there. I was charged with security for 10 intercontinental ballistic missiles. That wasn't the hard part. The hard part, they were spread over 50 square miles of land, and you had to respond to those then. I don't want to get too much detail. I'll be here all night.
Yeah, sure. Do you want to talk a little bit about the incident itself then? So leading from the moment where you and John Burroughs spotted the craft to the point where you touched the craft, if you could give a brief description of that, if you could.
Okay. I had left the vehicle. I set up Airman Kabanzak. Keep in mind what we're doing is what I was doing. I was the only one who was running my checklist. What I was doing is I was responding to a possible aircraft downing. So I took the vehicle as far as I could, I put Airman Kabanzak there. He had the only other radio besides me. And he was going to act as the entry controller for the responding forces that would come there for the crash. This is all standard operating procedures that we do and things like that. And then Aaron Burroughs and I proceeded toward the forest tree line. We had various type of lighting and stuff that was going on. From the distance at the east gate, it looked like a bubble of white light. As we got closer, to the tree line, it was multicolored, and it was starting to dim a little bit. all the things that were pretty inherent to aircraft crashes. Up to that point in time, I've been to a couple dozen aircraft crashes. I mean, there were just too many. But they all had inherent things like the coloring of, you know, titanium burning and fuel and stuff like that. So we were getting those colors weren't unusual. But as they got closer, I maintained our security checks with the East Gate. That's where Sergeant Chandler showed up. He was the flight sergeant for Bentwaters. And I was in charge of security for Woodbridge, so you had to have somebody else take my place, and that was Sergeant Chandler. And as we approached, I think the oddity was probably the feeling of physical feeling of static electricity that was on our clothing and face, hair, things like that. At first, I'll be honest with you, I thought it was adrenaline. No matter how many times you go to them, it's a shocking situation.
Yeah, I mean, you're coming up to a crashed, you've done it before, but, you know, adrenaline.
They're not pleasant. Yeah, they're not pleasant. Okay, it's probably the most horrifying thing you can imagine, aircraft crash. As I got closer, so we had Kabanzak, I had Burroughs, he's about 40 feet this way. Kabanzak was another 50, 75 feet back to the entry control point. And as I approached going into the forest, the light has dimmed down considerably. And I wasn't receiving any more transmissions from Central Security Control. I could barely hear Kabanzak. He was relaying my messages. I still transmitted. Security AOK, you know, whatever the codes were at the time. And then the lights had pretty much dissipated, but there was the Forestry Service they plant those as a crop, those trees. So they had berms, earthen berms, and they stood about anywhere from 2 to 4 feet high. And so I couldn't exactly see what was behind the one berm. It was just lit. I could see light coming out. Mm-hmm. there's that cold. I'm sorry.
No problem. Doing very well.
I'm so sorry about that. I'm going to do that throughout this. I guarantee it.
Okay.
All right. I think it's going to stop. Then there was, as I approached it, I could feel, you know, other things that were transpiring that just made no sense to me at all. My movements were labored. I used the comparison, the analogy, it would be like walking waist deep through a pool of water, that type of resistance I was having.
Were you having what emotions were you having? Were they kind of a bit of fear, trepidation? Was there curiosity there, maybe skepticism?
Well, the fear had left because at that point in time, I was close enough where I terminated the security response option for downed aircraft because I knew it wasn't a downed aircraft.
Okay.
And I initiated a security response option. What is called a helping hand situation. That's an Air Force term. I'm sure it's still used. There's a possible hostile situation is in front of you that could affect the priority A, B, or C resources of the base operating.
Okay.
So it's for a threat. And that's the way I had to treat it. Because of the time, it was just that, you know, it was the Cold War was on. We were having a lot of difficulty over in Europe at the time. And we're not even talking about the terrorist groups, a different type of terrorist group. They don't have those groups anymore. So we also had occasional like things like Russian trawlers and stuff like that that would come into the port there. And so, we initiated the security situation. As I came up over the crest of the berm, it was clear. This white light that was starting to dissipate, the forming of a black triangular craft, and I knew it was a hostile because the last thing that I would think is someone going to fly in a craft into a forest that has their trees separated maybe by 6 or 7 feet. It's impossible, That was one of the things I was confused about. How did it land there?
Yeah.
I mean, even helicopters require space.
So at the time, it's when you give your account in the book, it sounds like that everything was quite procedural in terms of the steps you would take and all the training that you'd had on how to deal with a situation like this. But at the same time, things are happening which are quite odd and out of place. So to what extent was your frame of mind kind of kept on the procedural side versus what's going on here?
Well, after the termination of the SRO for aircraft crash and initiation of the helping hand, it went pretty ad hoc after that. Okay. I mean, okay. <Yeah. I must say that one of the things that kept me grounded, I would say, as best as you could be grounded, is I would try to go ahead and say, well, first of all, up until this point, I mean, when I was at Offutt Air Force Base prior to this, I was with the Sakuli Guard, and you're the bodyguards for like 36 generals and all kinds of stuff like that. And you also did building security and also the briefings they would do with the other generals and stuff in NATO. That's in Omaha, Nebraska. And you'd provide security outside these doors, for these highly top secret, briefings. And most of them were on research and development. I mean, what kind of aircraft are we going to have 50 years from now? That kind of thing, or wish we would have in 50 years from now. Mm-hmm. And there was nothing that I ever seen at Offutt in any of those top secret briefings that would even come close to the technology that I was observing.
Yeah.
So that was perplexing. Okay, so it's not a Warsaw Pact nation. It's not ours. Okay, it doesn't leave a lot of options. Okay. What was your next question?
Well, I guess I was thinking about the emotions, and what was the emotions quite? Are your emotions now, when you think about it, quite raw still? Is your memory quite vivid still, do you feel?
Oh, it's vivid. Raw is a good one. I tell you what, I never do any events in December. None. I don't talk. I don't do anything with,
So December's still a tricky month for you.
It's horrible. It's a horrible month. Yeah. I mean, here we are, 42 years later. It's going to be, it's going to suck. I know that. And they say you can get used to things. I don't think you can get used to certain things. I think there's, do you have trauma or something like that? There was trauma. I had a mixture of emotions that were like rapid. I mean, going from fear at one moment to high anxiety to at one point in time, I was like, I felt everything was okay and I didn't feel threatened. And that's because the craft itself, just stopped doing things that looked like it was active, like the lighting in the skin of the craft and things like that. It got very just inert. I wasn't sure if I was going to survive this because I thought, well, first of all, it's not a Warsaw Pact country. It's not from us. You know, it's not from any Air Force I know of. So the chances are this is probably not a good situation to be in. So, and this is where I started to refocus. I said, well, what you need to do is you need to obtain as much information as you can, make sure it's passed on. So I kept my radio, I kept briefing on the radio, even though I couldn't hear a thing mm-hmm. back. And then I decided to pull my notebook out and do an on-ground investigation to get enough information, you know, so whether something happened to me or not out there, it didn't matter. The information would be able to be passed on to, you know, command authority, and those folks would have the opportunity to make a decision what happened out there, you know.
You must have felt quite alone, and you're probably quite
I was alone. I was alone. I had Burrell's back behind me standing, and he was just standing there. He was just frozen.
This is the weird thing. I mean, he's mentioned in other interviews that he didn't have the same experience as you, and I wonder...
He don't remember anything. He doesn't remember anything. He don't remember nothing. But that's not exactly true, because when we went into the, within the 2 days after that, we went into the base commander's office and all that stuff. Hey, he drew a triangular craft. He talked about it, briefed Colonel Hall about it, mm-hmm. and so he had fine memory. Where I found out he didn't have memory at all is when I met him again, I think it was 10 or 15 years later. We were out of service by then, and he just told me, I don't remember anything. He goes, oh, something happened there where you can't remember. That's strange. But in the book, I do talk about one of the things that came up there to explain that. And it's a hypothesis. I don't know this for 100% for sure. But what we had actually meant, shut that off. We had met him outside the law enforcement desk. I mean, this is like a week or two or maybe a week afterwards. It was myself and a couple other people, and I mention them in the book who they are. And I said, where are you going? He said, well, I gotta go down the OSI building. They want to talk to me. I said, just tell them everything. I says, this hopefully this goes away, you know. And he goes, okay, that's what I'll do. He said, that's what I'll do. I said, okay. And I think because of what happened to me, I think that he actually maybe had some type of I don't know, something happened to him down there. I don't know. But, I've talked to people in the CIA and everything else that says, those memories can't stay. They can't keep them from you forever. You're going to remember eventually. Mm-hmm. I go, okay. Like I went, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. I go, oh.
Yeah.
So I don't have an explanation for him.
Yeah.
I don't know one thing. He was young. He was a airman. He was excitable. He was terrible excited out there. It caused me problems, actually. Yeah. Matter of fact, in the book, since you did read that, Joe, in the book, the thoughts I was having about John at the time and Ed and what was going on around me, that is from the hypnosis session I had when I got out of the service after I retired, and I couldn't sleep at night. And that was one of the things that turned out being described, and these are not like UFO people. Okay. These are like my medical doctor recommended a psychiatrist to help me with this. And, so they had no attachment to this type of stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, it was purely to help me sleep at night. And which they did help with medication and stuff. That helped. I still take the same medication today, matter of fact.
For helping to sleep and stuff.
It's an alpha blocker. It actually keeps you from like having terrifying, horrifying dreams. Okay, it's horrible. I don't know how to explain it to anybody.
No way.
It's bad, and I don't want anybody to really understand how bad it is, because it's bad. Because I wish that on anybody. So that's why he doesn't remember. I don't know. I have no idea.
It's one of those mysteries, but. It seems like, I mean, you also mentioned, I think, in the book, and that there was a sort of a weird time distortion going on, that maybe your experience of time was different to his. Is that possible?
Yes, that is a theory, okay? I like to separate fact from theory, okay? That's my thought, because it seemed like all the surrounding around me, when I was up near the craft, let's say within the bubble of it, that I called it in the book, the bubble area, within the 5 feet, 8 feet of the craft, it seemed like everything outside this lighted area, first of all, I couldn't hear anything mm-hmm. out there. I didn't see any movement. I didn't see Kabansack wasn't moving. I mean, he's a good 60, 70 feet away, so he wasn't moving either. So that's why I've come up with this determination, and with others, have theorized that this is a time distortion. And it makes sense according to the people that researched it, because it seemed like it took a while for what was happening at the craft to catch up with the exterior outside there. And one of the theories, part of it is that probably for Airman Burroughs, it was probably instantaneous, the time from the flash of light when we hit the ground. It's probably all instantaneous for him, and you don't remember anything. But believe me, I was pretty shocked to find out what he didn't know. It don't make no sense to me either, as long as you brought it up. But don't make no sense. I was still in the service in 1990, and I think Halt and Burroughs did a documentary. I can't remember the name of the documentary. I think it had Robert Stack was the host on it, but I can't remember the name of the documentary. And anyway, they recreated it, and in that in that television segment, he describes a triangular craft, the three of us looking at it, doing things with it. And now it's like he don't know what's going on with it. I don't know. Those are questions you gotta ask him.
Jim, this really is fascinating, and I just want to sum up some of the key points so far, because, and also link them back to theories that have emerged within the contact community, and there seems to be some parallels here. So first and foremost, your initial feeling was a feeling of static electricity. So the whole area, and how far away from this object were you feeling this feeling of like a static energy in the air?
Oh, the static energy, I felt 20 feet away.
20 feet away, but no.
Yeah, it was really interesting on that part. It had residual energy because the landing site there, because when Sergeant Nevels went out there to investigate it, and he was sent out by the base commander, Colonel Conrad, the following morning to investigate, he felt the same thing. And I'm pretty sure he described it in his chapter in the book. The static electricity was still there at the landing site. So, and that's with the absence of the craft. So
you felt that obviously this object was giving off a substantial amount of energy, and you physically felt that. That's very interesting. You going back to the point you made earlier on about you mentioned earlier on about the transmissions being blocked. Do you think, and you only heard very little stuff coming from the base. Do you think there's any possibility that maybe that energy release was blocking conventional communication systems for a short period of time?
Well, I think so, because there's no way the twin bases are only separated from 3 miles apart, but between those twin bases and on the bases, we had radio repeating systems all over the base. I mean, there's no way to have a dead spot. I mean, they had to be received. In the book, I just cut to the chase on that. I found out afterwards from Sergeant Coffey, the senior controller at Central Security Control, that he hands me the 1569 when I get in there the next morning, because I was going to write it. I got all my times. I'm converting them from military time to from civilian time to military time, doing those kind of things. And he hands me the 1569, which is the incident complaint report. See, a blotter entry is just what is a chronological entry that goes into his blotter, what's happening and by time. And it's very brief. And it referred to the incident complaint report. And in there, that was like a page and a half. It was solid typed. And that he hands it to me, and I'm like, he said, "Read it." He said, "You already got the 1569 done, you know?" And he says, "Yeah." And I went, "Okay." And I was trying to, like, how in the hell does he know all the stuff that I seen out there? It's because it was 100% correct, because he heard all the transmissions, every bit of them. He heard them. So, in answer to your question now, James, there was blocking, but it wasn't blocking my transmission. I just couldn't hear them. Okay. So I don't know the answer to that. that question, what would cause that?
Okay? No, sure. So basically you've got a black triangular object that is obviously, this is based on the witness testament, manipulating space, time, and sound. In the area that it's landed.
Yes.
So I suppose coming on to a slightly separate point here, if bearing in mind that this sort of slowdown that you experienced, there's one question that I'd like to ask you now, and this is something I don't think you've ever mentioned in the book. Have you personally ever had anything happen to you during your military career where you involve what is traditionally known as a near-death experience?
I've been in some bad situations. Yes.
Were you ever revived at all?
Oh, no. Nothing like that. No.
Okay.
No. That's really near death. Okay.
Yeah.
being resuscitated. I mean, that's no. Thank God for that. That's bad.
Yeah. No. Sure. But going on to the point you made about Burroughs and the fact that he obviously recalled it, you know, and in his briefing to Colonel Hall. Do you think, and you mentioned about the OSI, he had to go and speak to OSI. Were any of your team, do you think that they were either threatened or scared of reprisals from you know, the upper echelons of the military or the intelligence community at all?
I don't know if it's that per se. I know they were worried, they were concerned. It was here's the thing, to report exactly what it possibly was is probably a career ender anyway, and they're probably all worried about that. OSI, yeah, they had a lot of investigative power, but I knew most of the OSI agents. The people that interviewed me weren't OSI. I don't know who they were. So I know one thing, that OSI at the time, during wartime or during contingency operations, they would actually fall under the State Department over there. So you can conclude what you want out of that, you know.
Yeah.
I don't know. So the fear of it, they were fearful that night. So I don't. I'm not sure what the fear was afterwards, though.
But you weren't threatened by senior officers. You weren't sort of coerced into trying to keep quiet. Nope. Now that's a positive piece of information, really. And as far as the typical view of the UFO community is that obviously that there's continual discussion point is to what degree this has been covered up. Is there an ongoing cover up? Who is behind that cover up? And no one can answer these questions.
Well, you know, it's what they did do is they did make a containment story. You know, right. They played right along with the UFO community with that, you know, so that fit in really well, especially when, you know, the following night and day when Monroe Nevels was out there and Colonel Hall, they seen lights in the sky and, you know, hey, that fit in pretty good.
It does seem does seem different to Roswell in a way. I mean, I see it as the English version of Roswell, but there is a difference in terms of the cover up because Roswell was reported as a UFO crash. And then it obviously things changed quite dramatically soon after. So it seems obvious that there was a very strong change of direction on the narrative on that. But with Rendlesham, that doesn't seem to have happened, at least, it seems.
Well, no, but what they did do is they, made everything top secret, like, after 24 hours. So any of the airmen or anything like that, they had secret clearances. And believe me, the Air Force gives those out, okay? Everybody had, like, secret clearances. And unless they had a top secret clearance, which I did, and then Monroe Nevels did, and course Colonel Halt did, I mean, we were in a different circle of being in the know versus them. I mean, I was constantly being talked to, or we've been briefed, or more questions were asked or stuff like that, lots of meetings, and it was pretty open. And in that environment, in that top secret environment, it was open because we were brainstorming to find out what it could be, what we thought it could be. We never did come to conclusions, but there's no doubt it wasn't one of ours. I mean, or wasn't one of theirs either. We knew that because there's just too much concern.
Well, based on an understanding of where military technology is now, and not just military technology, but civilian technology as well, in this day, right now.
Right.
Do you think the fact that, although, I mean, I don't want to get in the way of Joe's questions later on about the hieroglyphs, et cetera, but if the craft was, you didn't see any occupants, do you think there's any possibility that this craft could have been some kind of drone?
Unmanned?
Yeah.
Without a physical pilot? No, I never thought it was manned. Never.
Right.
I mean, when we say drone, we don't necessarily mean built human-made drone, but a drone, if an ET drone maybe as well as an option. But
yeah. Mechanical device that didn't have a pilot.
Yeah, right.
Even the technology from then, and there's so many examples of it, can't be replicated today. I mean, aircraft, there's certain things aircraft got to have to fly. I mean, they got to have aerons, they gotta have, you know, flaps, they gotta have intakes, they gotta have exhausts, they gotta displace air, they gotta make noise. I mean there's so many things, even the air displacement when it takes off. I mean, there's sonic booms. I mean, how do you not have a sonic boom from something that takes off at a speed of a 30-odd-6 round, you know, 3,000 miles an hour? How do you do that? I mean, the technology was pretty advanced. It's so advanced it can't be replicated.
Yeah.
And even though they're trying, you can see they're trying to do it, but they're a long ways from it. I mean, just take the part about the craft was on legs, but not a landing gear. There were light protruded, came down.
Yeah.
And I use the term light.
Yeah.
I use the
term light.
Yeah, I'm using the term light because it's the easiest way for a 21st century man to explain it. Light. Is it light? Obviously not. It held up an object. It held up an object and it made impressions of the ground. Okay. I mean, so it wasn't light. It was a technology that was unknown. Do we have that today? No. Okay. I mean,
yeah. And turning back
to I'm gonna bring that up. Going back to John Burroughs. Mm-hmm. After we came back in and that we went back out, he's the one that found the impressions of the ground, not me. I didn't need to see him.
Okay.
I said, he kept saying, come over here and look at this. I said, no, I don't want to go over there. He says, come over here and look at this. And finally, you know, because he was nagging me, I went back over and says, okay. And it was like, I should have known then, because he says, there's impressions of the ground. And I'm thinking, yeah. I don't understand. I was confused why he was so impressed by impressions of the ground. You know, I mean, turns out later, after the team from Langley came in, with the air temperature and ground temperature from that night, they could measure it, and they said that the craft, it was very light. It only weighed 7 tons, and that is light for an aircraft. Mm-hmm. You know. But it made that
was from the impressions in the, so they could tell the weight.
Right.
Okay.
Right. Those are things that, you know, came out afterwards and after action reports and stuff like that. So, and, you know, stuff like that was shared, you know, from the base commander and, you know, the deputy, Colonel Hall. And yeah, I mean, I got to talk to, General Williams after he retired. Not too long ago, so maybe 2013, 14, something like that. And I mean, actually, I met him out in Tucson. We had lunch, and Burroughs was there too. And you know, he was quite open about it. He was, even then, he was only when Burroughs would leave to go to the bathroom or something like that, he would ask me further questions. He would only ask me certain questions when I was alone. He wouldn't do it in front of anybody else. Mm-hmm. So, which I was fine. And then, of course, in the course of writing the book, I just told him I'm going to write a book. And because the other one we did, I wasn't satisfied with. It didn't tell enough. It was too, they were too worried about monetary things, okay, what's sold and shit like that. who cares? You know, I don't understand that part. And you know, we worked back and forth. Unfortunately, his eyesight was really bad. And so most of it was during emails and stuff like that. But sometimes on the phone we'd talk. And, you know, he supported me all the way through it. And unfortunately, he died about a year before the book came out, a year and a half. Terrible loss. And but Colonel Conrad, he assisted us too, right up to, and Colonel Conrad is fine right now, alive and well, and he helped us to go right up through you know, the publishing of the book. Matter of fact, Monroe Neville's chapter that he wrote in there, that was reviewed by Colonel Conrad, and he stood behind it 100%. Okay. He says, 100% accurate. He goes, go with it.
I have to say, Jim, that this is so refreshing to hear this, because actually hearing you talking about this is giving me a brand new impression of the military and intelligence community that I haven't had before, and that's of getting an overwhelming sense of integrity and support from some of your COs, and the fact that actually what I'm picking up from here more than anything else is something I've never had ever where this whole phenomenon is concerned, which is actually the motivation to try and go for containment wasn't driven by anything more than, first of all, many people were scared about the reaction that they would have to talking about this, but mm-hmm. also the fact that they just couldn't answer any questions about it. So, and that in itself would put them in a difficult position, which was nothing to do. It was not their fault at all. So,
that's why I doubt anybody's story when they say they weren't supported by the military. Okay. I doubt it, because I'm going to tell you what, and I can't remember what chapter it is, but Joseph will tell you, it's the one with Colonel Highbush. He's the base commander that base commander. He wasn't the base commander, but he probably wanted to be. I don't know. he replaced Major Zickler after the incident. That should be clue you in right there. A full colonel from the Pentagon, that's where he worked, is assigned now to take over as Major Zickler after this incident. And the first 2 days, within the first 2 days, I was working on plans and programs. And I mean, you know, we wrote the plans, security plans for that and all kinds of stuff. And so it was like a day, or he'd been there a day or two. And my boss gets a call and he says, "Hey, the squadron commander wants to see you up at the office." I said, "Oh, he probably wants a briefing, you know, some of these plans." We had plans for everything, okay? And he says, "Well," he said, "I take up this one here and I take up this other one." I said, "Okay." I says, "That sounds good." And so I go up there and he says, I go on in there and I go to report, you know, and while I'm holding those books, and he says, "Oh, no, no, no." He says, "It's okay." He says, "Hi." He says, I'm Chuck Highbush." I says, "Okay, I'm Jim Penniston." You know, I'm like, what is this? And he says, he went over and shut all the doors and he hollered to the lieutenant out there. He says, "Bring in 2 cups of coffee, please." And the guy did. And he says, "Sit down." He says, "I want you to know," he says, "I read your statement at the Pentagon on Rendlesham." I says, "Really?" He goes, "Yeah." I says, "Well," I says, "You mean like the 4-page one?" He goes, "Yes." And I said, "Okay." He says, "I want you to know, if you have any questions, if you have any problems, I'm here to help. You can always come to me." And he was that way. Even after he left the base, I still seen him. And he still checked up all the while we were in for the remaining amount of time. So to say the Air Force didn't care, they made sure that I had someone that I could go to and someone I could talk to about it if there's a problem came up.
Yeah.
So if anybody says they don't have any, that they don't trust anything with the military and they try to, I got some really high suspicions about that when they say that kind of stuff. They don't have the support, you know, and,
Well, just to fill you in, Jim, the in the local area, there was a lot of Chinese whispers in the local community about the whole incident. And one of the main pieces, one of the biggest Chinese whispers that was going around that fueled information being gossiped about was the fact that the local people were under the impression that all the people in the patrol that you were in were told not to talk about it and disbanded to different parts of the world, which is obviously, by the sounds of things, not true at all. So that's
well, if you said treat it as top secret, no, some people didn't have access anymore. And I'll tell you what, it was a problem for me. I don't know if I put it in the book or not, but one of the problems was the guys I worked with, the guys that were working with me that night that were at Woodbridge in Bentwaters, you know. After they said, you know, treat it as top secret, and, you know, they say, what happened? I said, "I can't. I got to treat it as top secret." And they go, "Oh, shit, really?" And I go, "Yeah." And everybody's like, "Bummer," you know, because they wanted to know, too. They had questions. They had different vantage points than I did. Like, I never seen a land. The people at working security patrol over at Bentwaters, Sergeant Hall, and they seen a land. They couldn't figure out what the hell that was. It was controlled landing. Then we had people that are working in Annapolis, the aircraft parking areas at Woodbridge, and they were like, "Okay, we seen it take off. Holy shit!" You know, they said you can't talk about it. Not no more. I says they classified it, to, you know, top secret. And they go, "Okay," and that's what we had to do. But that killed me not to say anything. And matter of fact, when we were writing this book, so many questions came in through the internet, you know, with Facebook and those social groups. the people that were there that night, I say, hey, if you got any questions, you got anything you think I should be brought up or anything, you know, if you want me to bring it up, can I use your name? All of them said no names. Nobody wants their names. I said, I fully understand that. And a couple of people did. There was a couple of people, but which I was okay with. And they're great people for letting me do that. And Bertolino, for example, he let me use his name. Was he key? Yeah, he's a witness. We're all witnesses, you know. He was there on the transport back with me to CSC after I came back in out of the field, and he kept trying to talk to me. They know what I seen exactly. I'm going over my notes so I can do that 1569 report up. So by the time we got to CSC, and I said, Bert, I'm busy, man. I said, I'm busy. I'm trying to get this stuff together. Okay, but in the book, yeah, he see me, writing certain things down like that. But there's nothing unusual. I made every one of my guys have a notebook. I said, you're going to make sure you have correct times if anything happens. You're going to make sure you have correct names. You have notebooks. I made sure every one of my guys had notebooks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
that's just the way it is. And you know what? It works. The other thing it made a little bit nicer to write a book, and it wasn't the reason I actually did it, but every day I was in the Air Force, I kept journals, everything that happened during the day for 20-some years. That's a lot of journals, I want to tell you. And I would use them, we're going to do a base security council meeting, and I could go to Colonel Williams and say, Colonel Williams, here's what happened at the last one, and here's what the deputy commander of maintenance says he was going to do this. He goes, what is that? I said, this is your cheat sheet. I said, it's to hold them all accountable from last year's meeting. Mm-hmm. Colonel Williams says, thank you very much, Sarge. And they thought the colonel was brilliant at those meetings. He goes, wait, you didn't say that last year. Here's what you said. You said this. And they're just like, oh, man, the old man, he remembers everything. See? Made him look good. And that's the whole thing about the military. You want to make your boss look good.
So in terms of taking notes, did you also – it seems like you also took photos with a camera. Was that right? You had some sort of –
Yeah, I did, but none of those turned out.
Really?
And I thought – that – well, they were whited out. And when we got them – done. And I thought something happened because of the base photo lab and that. But then I found out years later from Monroe Nevels, whose hobby is a photography, he took his own pictures and developed his own pictures, and his were whited out too. Okay. And I said, well, how in the hell can that be, Monroe? He says, radiation.
Hmm. Possibly.
That's what caused it. No, he said beta radiation. Oh, yeah. Monroe Neville says it's beta radiation. That's what it is.
Yeah,
he was an expert. He's an expert on it. That's why he was out there investigating it. So I says, oh, that makes sense. So
what kind of camera was it? Is it quite an old developed?
Monroe's cameras, you'd have to ask him, but I know that there'd be high-end film kind.
Okay.
The one I had out there was mainly for aircraft crashes, taking pictures of people trying to record our tail numbers or our planes and stuff and suspicious activity. It was a Canon, I think A1. A1, I think it's what it is. I could be wrong about that. I'm pretty sure that's what it was. I only had black and white film anyway. That's all you have in it.
Mm. I'd love to see one of those pictures, but unfortunately, they're all white. There's nothing.
Yeah.
No impression.
Well, see, but there's some other ones that were taken, that were farther away. And of course, the daylight hours. I think that one of those is. It's been publicized. I mean, it shows the indentions and stuff like that. But the funny thing is that even the following day, when Monroe was out there investigating it, the actual landing site, which isn't that big, I mean, it was probably about 5 feet by 6 feet, 7 feet, something like that. It wasn't very big. Was still registering beta radiation, which normally doesn't last that long unless there's a lot of it. Mm-hmm. And that's what ran up the trees too, where it took off, you know. Mm-hmm. Now, like Monroe said, the good thing is it wasn't gamma. You know, he says, "Why is that?" And Monroe said, "Well, we wouldn't, none of us would be here. It was gamma radiation." So, okay, he says, "But that's why you had a sense of touch. It was warm to touch." He says,
"Yeah."
He says, "That's part of it." I said, "Okay." So, you know, through the years, we sort of sussed these things out. We figured them out, you know.
Yeah.
Some are just very logical conclusions. Some are hypotheses. I make sure that you guys know whether or not it is a fact or not, because I think there's enough of the disinformation going on from everybody out there. I don't know. Hey, that's the other thing. They're all trying to make money off this.
Yeah.
That's what it is. I have never made money off Rendlesham. I there's no way in the world I would have thought that that was a good idea. Okay. Because I looked at it as the thing happening around Christmas is probably a gift to begin with, the information. And so my honorariums, all the book proceeds, my portions of that, they go to charity, and I have some great charities that I give. So that's not my motivation. Okay. Yeah. It's not for, 3 seconds of fame or something like that either. I'm actually a pretty private person. And I usually only go out when I start hearing, I get tired of hearing too much disinformation about Rendlesham, and then I start talking about it. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, I've been pretty quiet about it.
Yeah.
Well, it's only through, really brave former service men and women being prepared to come forward and tell their story that, we can start to get a clearer picture and try and understand, and it contributes to quality research. I mean, I have to say that it's to a degree, I'm starting to understand the thinking that's gone into things like the containment around this and, the attempts to try and stifle it. I mean, there's no, I think the some of the noises that have been coming out of declassified bits and pieces of information now, and certainly what some senators are saying, there was a general question mark, I think, that's coming out that, and this has probably been the same for the past 50, 60 years. Would the public really be able to cope with this information? I mean, if even if your story had come out in 1980, would that have been a positive thing, do you think, or would it have scared a lot of people?
I don't think it's about that. Yeah. It's about power.
Right. Okay.
The technology is power. Okay. Do you have access to that technology and understand how to use that technology is power, and that's what it's all about. Say they don't care about if people are upset over UFOs or they don't care about that. Another thing that you got to really be careful about on this, James, is just because it comes from the government doesn't mean it's true.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I agree.
Okay, there is so many false flags going on right now. It's ridiculous, and Congress is one of them. That's a false flag. That whole thing with the they're going to release the information and all these secret things, and that's a false flag operation. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Look over here, not here. Yeah. Look over here, not here.
Oh yeah. Well versed in all this, definitely.
No, I know. And you know what? We sit there, we talk about this. The other people are involved, by the way, that I talked to, it's false flag. I mean, Monroe and I, we were talking about the in particular, the release for the Congress. I don't know what their motivation is, but it has nothing to do with UFOs, all right. It's a false flag. It keeps people quiet. It gets votes. I don't know what it does. Okay. It's, who knows?
Yeah,
and don't believe everything that comes out of the Pentagon. I don't believe that.
Yeah. I mean, it begs the question, if there's so many false flags going on and you know, people with integrity like yourself are able to come forward and tell their story and tell the truth, how on earth are we ever going to evolve as a race when all this crap is going on? It begs belief.
Well, unfortunately, I think it's all about power and control. So
yeah, I agree.
And I don't know if we haven't done well for the last 4,000 years. So it's been about power and control for 4,000 years. I don't think it's going to change, not in the near future anyway. You know, I know it's horrible. I agree with you, James. It's not a good situation at all.
If I can ask you, because Joe's got some really really good questions come up, but just one more from me before he cracks.
You ask all you want, James.
Thank you very much. Who do you think, in your opinion, I mean, having obviously been looking at this for years, who do you think is behind the major decisions to go move towards containment and covering this up?
Well, it's not sitting in the Pentagon. Okay, it's not there. It's not. I'll tell you what. It goes to classifications. Presidents come and go, so do members of Congress, okay? And I'm going to talk about the U.S., and I don't think it's any better in the U.K., okay? They come and go, some more often than others, but it's happening all the time. So what they do in America, and the Brits do the same thing, by the way. They just have different ways of doing it, but they do the same thing. Official Seekers Act, that's the beginning of it. But in America, what they do with classification system is that we have the Freedom of Information Act, okay? FOIA requests and that, you get stuff. But the way to do it is, what they do is they go ahead and fund. Let's say the Pentagon, they create a department, give it $50 million in the Pentagon, and their investigation is space anomalies. Unknown space anomalies, okay? That's what their job is. Okay, then what they do, that is probably a top secret program, okay? And then what they do is they go ahead and subcontract it out to civilians, okay? And what they have under where the money is showing it's going is a special access program. Mm-hmm. But then they go ahead and fund it out to contractors, civilians. And what those are not special access programs, but they are unknown special access programs, okay? Meaning, and that's not the correct term, it's another word to use in there. And what that means is, if you did a FOIA request, I don't care if you're a member of Congress, I don't care if you're president of the United States, you would not find the answer. There would be no answer. There'd be no paper trail for it, okay? You don't know what those civilians were doing in this agency. That's where these people come up with the name Black Departments. Yeah, that's how it happens, okay? And there's those things happening all the time, or happening right now as we talk. And that's where the control is actually being, I think, done at there. But to say that there's a department within the U.S. government that does these kind of things? No.
There's two governments, as people say. There's the government that we kind of associate with, and there's this kind of one behind the scenes, which is, as you say, maybe born out of these special access programs that seem to have had...
There's a shadow government. Sure, there is. There's a government within the government. There, yeah, I think so. There, but when you start developing stuff, and that's where this Kit Green King thing came in, and he's working for Bigelow Aerospace when he contacted me again in 2014, 15. And he's telling all kinds of stuff, you know, what they want to do. It's about power. They want to know what the reason they were talking to me, and they were also talking to John. I thought they wanted me to, they told me, and he says, here's what Kit Green said. He says, if you cooperate, he said, we'll guarantee you. He said, I'll make sure this happens. You will have 100% disability and collect a check from the VA. I'm thinking, well, I'm a retired Air Force. I don't really need a check, you know, because you can't double dip anyway, by the way. And I went, okay, so how are you going to do this? He says, well, he says, we have doctors. We'll just say that this situation happened with you and this. And I says, no. I says, there's no way I can do that. I says, when we actually have people coming back from with traumatic head injuries and missing body parts, to scam the VA, I wouldn't do that. That came from Kit Green. Okay, so I'm just going to do it. There's some other people that did participate, though. And I will leave that nameless.
For sure. I wonder if you could turn back to the craft. And you mentioned that it was warm to touch, the feel it was generating. But you also said in the book that it had these weird hieroglyphs on it.
Yeah, externally, that was one of the first things I noticed as we, you know, I did the walk around. The craft itself, I used the term black glass because it was dark. It felt that smooth. But there's no doubt about it. It was some kind of metal, okay? I mean, it wasn't glass. And so I went from touching the craft itself, and when I got to the glyphs, they were like etched into the side of the craft. And I used the comparison to make it easy for people to understand. It felt like going from a smooth black glass to like sandpaper. That's the type of etching. And these glyphs were, I didn't have nothing to measure out there. It was just
me. Were the glyphs sort of proud of the glass, or were they kind of at the same level?
Etching is the best. It's etching above the it's level. Above, okay. Maybe fractionally, you know.
Yeah, and when you touched them, you said that you received this code. We can come on to the code in a bit more detail. But how you described it? Were you sort of paralyzed at the time when you received the code, or were you kind of in control of your movements?
Well, when I touched the, you know, the bigger one, which was the triangular glyph, I mean this, the forest was pitch black except for the area where that craft was. It was sort of lit up, and when I touched it, it was just a brilliant light, and I couldn't see anything else. And that's when I seen the ones and zeros, which doesn't mean nothing to me at the time. It was insanity or something. I don't know what it was. It's crazy. And I was stunned, I guess. And I just sort of had got my senses back, and I just lifted my hand off and it stopped. Now, I used the term light again for that, blinding white light. Mm-hmm. It obviously wasn't light. And here's a fact why it wasn't light. Because after taking my hand off, I had 100% of my night vision. And there's no way on this earth you could have that kind of bright light and not it take you 45 minutes to another hour to get your night vision back. I had it immediately. So
your eyesight felt like it was just before, hadn't changed in terms of how you could perceive the world around you.
Right.
Yeah.
It was just, that's why I've come to the conclusion that it was a transmission.
Yeah.
Okay. I don't want you to think I'm just guessing or something like that. I mean, it was the night vision is probably the biggest clue there's no way that you can have your full night vision after being blinded by this light.
Yeah.
I couldn't see nothing. It was bad.
So you received this transmission, and you say that was it on that night you couldn't sleep until you wrote this down into your notebook?
Well, the following day, you know, when we got off work, I mean, I was pretty keyed up. I went back out there. We got plaster of Paris. We did this stuff.
And, oh, yeah, yeah.
It was a busy day, you know, but I wanted to be busy, okay? And anyway, so finally it gets around nighttime that night, and I know I'm tired, or very tired, and I said, I got to go to sleep. And, I was having trouble trying to get to sleep because I kept seeing these ones and zeros. I said, oh, every time I close my eyes, what the hell is this? And I was really concerned because I was concerned about the trauma from the event because I thought I was losing it, actually. And that's pretty much it. I couldn't go and, like, call up the base hospital and go up there and try to explain, even begin to explain what happened that day before. And, anyway, I was pretty concerned about it. So I got up and I couldn't sleep anyway. So I made a pot of coffee. I don't know. It was like midnight. I pulled out my notebook because I wanted to go ahead and look over some of the stuff I read, you know, wrote down and stuff in there. And I says, you know, I think I can write those down. So I just flipped to some open pages in the back, and I started writing, you know, the 00111 0. And the thing is, when I was doing that, it felt good. I went, oh, so I just kept writing. As a matter of fact, at a certain point, my pen jammed. I mean, it was the ink clouded up and I couldn't write anymore. So I'm like panicking, going through the drawer, trying to find a pen that works. And I went back to it and I started writing again. And I wrote them all out, 16 pages. I wrote them all out. And when I got to one point, it was like, I don't see them anymore. And I feel good.
Mm-hmm. So you can't see them now? If you tried to imagine them, could you see them now, do you think?
Yeah, but it's not
not the same.
It's not the same, no. Okay. No, it's not the same. Okay. No, that was pretty intense. I was just
yeah, imagine.
Yeah, I don't good question, but it was pretty intense. Yeah, it's not the same though. But can I? Yeah. Yeah, but it's not the same.
And what kept you from sharing that for so many years?
Because I thought it was a mental breakdown.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's the last thing I'm going to do for the remaining time I got in the Air Force. And I tell you what, it's just really by chance after I got out, by going in there for a sleep disorder, that the hypnosis was even done. And if it wasn't for that, see, I think the Achilles heel with the investigators on this at the OSI and whoever those other people were is that they didn't know I had a notebook. They didn't know I had written the binary down. I think that's their Achilles heel on it. As far as knowing that if it was important, I didn't think it was important. After what I seen that night, nothing was important, you know, other than what you experienced. And then we're doing a film shoot down in Florida, in Phoenix. I can't remember when, 2010, something like that. And I had taken them all out at one time, but I replaced them back in. They're all lucid and a loose leaf. And I had the film shoot down in Phoenix, and that was with Howell, Linda Howell, and Burroughs, and oh, it was for ancient aliens. That's what it was. Mm-hmm. And so they were using film then. It wasn't digital. And they asked, John asked me about a date, about time. And I said, I don't know, maybe I got it written down. Because I recorded all kinds of stuff, you know, like a meeting at the pub and stuff like that. And I'm looking through it, and I went back too far. And, you know, of course, all the ones and zeros are there. And he goes, what's that? I'm thinking, what the hell? I'm out of the Air Force now. I'll tell him what the hell. I'll tell him about this. And I didn't even get a chance to tell him about it. I said, well, I just said that. I wrote them down that, you know, the night we got back in. And Howell says, well, you know what that is? And I told her, yeah, it's like insanity. She said, that's binary code. I went, binary code. That's when I found out it was binary code. I didn't know anything about it. And then they, you know, everybody was like, you know, they had saliva coming down their mouth, you know, over the stuff. Okay. It was crazy. And it was. I've never seen anything like it. Of course, it's insanity, right? Well, I mean, that's what it is. They said, it means something. We're going to get it decoded. I guess
they're thinking this is a message from some extraterrestrial civilization.
I guess. I don't know. Yeah, they've been drinking Kool-Aid too long. You know what I mean? That Kool-Aid. And anyway, I went home and back to Chicago. And, man, Howell was bothering me every day on the phone. Every day. She was bothering about that. And Burroughs was no better. And anyway, so I get a call from the Ancient Aliens, Kim Sharon, and she says, we want to go ahead and have that checked out. I said, Kim, I says, it was this trauma, man. I said, there ain't nothing there. And she goes, well, just let us try it. And, you know, if it is, it is. We'll keep it to ourselves. And I said, okay. So I don't know, I sent her like five or six pages. I can't remember where I sent her five pages, I think. And then she gets hold of me like 2 days later. She is excited. She made me come up on the internet so I could view it. I'm not sure. We didn't have the social media like we have today. It was some other thing they had. And she told me, you know, this is the message. And they had a message on there, you know, yeah. Coordinates and all this stuff. And you know, it was a message. So I said, you know what? I says, okay. I said, let's keep it quiet for now. And so I photocopied five pages, scanned them, and I sent them to Howell. It shut her up, too. She said, oh, I haven't investigated, so I go for it. Because I don't think it, I don't know, I thought maybe Ancient Aliens was pulling something. I mean, yeah. I wasn't sure. And she gets a hold of some some guy down in, a doctor down in Australia, and there's another one over in the UK, not in the UK, but North Carolina. And they do a decipher on it. And so she calls me excited like 4 days later. Guess what? I said, just tell me what you think it says. And she read exactly what Ancient Aliens said. And says, and then I told her, she said, well, you don't seem very excited. I'm a little bit relieved, I says, but no, I'm not excited. I says, I said, but it's good to know Ancient Aliens wasn't pulling my leg. Huh? She says, they already had this code and they deciphered it? I go, yeah. And she was pissed. I don't know why she was so pissed. You'd think the more people that looked at it, the better. I don't know. But that just tells you people have their own motivations.
Sure. See? But what's strange about this code, and just to give it a bit of context, it gives messages, it's got words in there, and it's also got coordinates. What seems strange about it is it seems to be like a puzzle piece in a jigsaw, not some it clear is. Message. And also it's done using a coordinate system that we're using. It's using English as a language, which you speak. It's, and I speak obviously, it's what, why is this craft, unless it was deliberately put there for this message to come to you, it seems very odd that the message had been done in binary, to using a binary code system as well that we would translate into the words we had. It's a puzzle, and it's in so many ways.
Oh, is this excellent questions. Did you see the work I sent you from Gary Osborne?
Yeah, I looked through that, and I've seen his interpretations with, including the PHY, the golden, the fine structure constant.
The fine structure constant, but the only time that's valid was at December 1980. Mm-hmm. The way the coordinates were on the planet.
I'm going to try and speak to Gary.
And then the other thing.
It's an enigma.
And then the other thing, they didn't have the technology until only a couple of years ago to actually understand that they had the fine structure constant and stuff from 1980 in there. So it's proof positive that the code is legit. I mean, it came from some intelligence somewhere. Okay. The fine structure constant is, to get something moved over to the chance of, 12 or 13 zeros. This is, chance of it being just arbitrary.
And I think what's strange is prior to you receiving the code, I think there was a message. I think it was Carl Sagan said that if we ever find a message and it has the fine structure constant in it, embedded in it, that will be clue to an advanced civilization. And then lo and behold, that was part of it. And that's his interpretation of showing that it's almost like a response from what we were saying. They were like listening to us and saying, well, so they want the fine structure constant in a message. Here you go. But somehow it was orchestrated in such a way that you wouldn't be able to interpret it to later, but the fine structure constant was from 1980.
The only way
to play here.
Well, so that means whatever intelligence is knows what was going to happen from 1980 to 2019. Mm-hmm. I mean, how do they do that?
Jim, if I can ask you this, and this is all linked to the central hypothesis. How many nuclear weapons were on the base when you were working there or in the area?
A lot.
More than 20?
Oh, I don't know exactly. Right. I really don't. All I know is that we had them. I don't know. They weren't the right ones anyway. We couldn't use them anyway. They were for a different aircraft.
No, but if the DEFCON rating had changed significantly, and obviously this was around the time of the Cold War, had things escalated, how quickly would that base have been able to get onto a sort of,
The weapons were useless for any aircraft we had.
So they'd have to have flown an aircraft in and deploy them through a different aircraft.
Somewhere else.
Mm-hmm. But that potentially could have happened within, 24, 48 hours?
It can happen real fast.
Yes. Was that the closest U.S. base to Russia at the time that had weapons on it like that?
Well, I'm not prepared to answer that.
No, sure.
I don't want to do that.
But it's going to be probably one of the closest in terms of a close.
Well, it's closer than the missile field in Montana. I mean, we also have our U.S. Navy submarines and everything else. They're all over the world. I wasn't trying to avoid it, but it's avoiding. I don't know the answer to that because, you could have subs in the North Sea. I don't know.
But equally, I suppose the point I'm trying to get to here is if we are working to the hypothesis that these were time travelers, did this one event involving you change the course of history? Because if that base had been able to go from, the weapons were useless unless they flew in a massive bomber or whatever else, then that base could have had a huge significance had there been a third world war and a nuclear conflict.
Well, it was significant. It was the largest tactical fighter wing in the world. Right. It's huge. And I tell you what, its mission was to go ahead and stop 5,000 tanks from crossing a point in Germany. And those A-10s would have went and took them out.
Okay.
So that was their job. We also had forward 8 to 10 bases in Germany that belonged to us at four different locations that would fly out, and they would stop that. It was for a conventional war.
Whether the war had been a nuclear conflict or a conventional war, it was of huge strategic significance.
Yes. It was a pivoting base in Europe. I know one thing. They would the Warsaw Pact countries and Soviet Union would love to have those two bases gone, non-existence. I mean, that'd make it a lot easier.
The time frames here, because everybody associates the end of the Cold War with the summit between Reagan and Gorbachev that took place in Iceland. Do you remember that?
Right.
And that was how long was that? I can't remember the time frame. Was that Christmas 1980 or the following year, 1981?
Well, I think it was about a year after that he got in there. I know he was dealing with the Iranian hostages. That's the first thing he did, January 20th of 81. He got them released. And I know that Reagan had the Soviets scared to death of their the space shield, that they're gonna talk about mega Star Wars. Yes.
Yeah.
Which, by the way, is still probably the best bet to protect all our countries is that concept, bubble over each country.
You bring up interesting points there, and you mentioned about time travelers, and I did want to know if you thought that maybe this was future humans as opposed to extraterrestrials.
Well, the evidence points to it, and what evidence is there? Well, why would they have a aircraft or a craft marked like we mark our aircraft? We put tail numbers on, all of us do. We mark our aircraft. They definitely marked theirs. The one in the forest that night was marked. It had glyphs on it. Why mark it?
And also the message itself at the end, it says 8100.
Yes.
That could be a reference to a future date, or could that be something completely different?
We went back and forth, the people that have been researching that. Half of them say yes, and the other half say no. Yeah, so they don't know, I guess. I know one thing, that the discoveries that it's producing from the code are pretty much mind-boggling. That's according to Gary. He's working with other doctors with this, other scientists. I don't want to say stuff and make it and say something wrong, okay? Because I get a little lost with it. But the evidence that he's shown me and has talked to me about is, this is just like proof positive. There's no doubt about it. That these are definitely some type of people that have the capability of interdimensional travel. That's really what we're talking about. Time travel is Hollywood. Interdimensional travel is what we're talking about.
And then the term extratempestual is getting coined as well.
Yeah. Doc, what's his name from Montana?
Is it Masters?
Yeah, brilliant guy, too. So that seems like that's probably the case. The thing is that It's that in fact that there are certain things that weren't known until certain dates. I mean, it just wasn't known with the code.
And so, the code does point to the idea that for us to proceed, for humanity to proceed, it has to take seriously a lot of the hidden truths around, like the pyramids of Giza and various other things. It seems that there's things for us to discover as humanity if we want to progress. I guess to get to where they are, if it is future humans, is it?
Yeah, and some of the discoveries that they've had over the last 5-6 years out of Giza, we already knew about because of the code. And it was like, well, this is saying that this is where this is at. This is what's going on here. And this is where a possible chamber is. And all of a sudden now they're like confirming everything that was, you know, thought or we knew from the code before. So there must be a wealth of knowledge waiting for us somewhere in Giza. So whether that's interesting, because as far as disclosure, that's how disclosure will happen. Mm-hmm. It'll be through that kind of, through the evidence.
Graham Hancock's just brought out a series on Netflix about all these things, and I think it's gaining... There's a lot of people viewing it. So, yeah, as they say, I think it's things like that that will be more more relevant to disclosure than the UFO, report or whatever from government. Yeah.
I agree. But the thing is, I don't agree with the alien hypothesis. There's no evidence. Zero. They have concluded that's what they are because that's what they think they are. Oh, so therefore they are. No, you can apply interdimensional travel to all this, every bit of them.
Certainly with the Rendlesham incident, but, you know, with all the other incidents out there of UFOs and things, you know.
Well, and one of the other hypotheses that Gary came up with is these grays and stuff, like with grays. These are actually manufactured biological units, according, you know, it's his theory. And it's because... the craft, going back to James, the craft was unmanned. I didn't feel that it was big enough, or I didn't see any way it could have been manned. That these are units that are designed or manufactured with human DNA or whatever, and that's so they can survive the interdimensional travel. That's mm-hmm. his theory. Humans can't. It's just too much. We can't do it. That's probably why they sent back a unmanned craft. You know, it's just they can't survive it. So, but they can send back messages. That's for sure. They can send back things like that.
So they've effectively, if we start to understand this, so there is a possibility here that a craft of unknown origin, human, future human, maybe not, has been sent back, has had has achieved a direct effect of altering the course of history, which would suggest that potentially the path we were on before December 1980 was potentially apocalyptic over the next 4 to 5 years. So not only have they potentially changed history, but they've also now given us information relating to certain potentially archaeological sites. And information in there could be directly relevant to our evolution as a race.
Nicely said.
Thank you.
It is. Nicely said. Yes.
So I think, I mean, that in itself.
That's our conclusion, what we've come up with, too. But yeah. Nicely said. We didn't use the same words. But I'll tell you what. Nicely said. And that's what we, my belief is on it, and so is Gary's. And
well, this all fits. I mean, you mentioned the work of Graham Hancock. There were a number of other authors as well that talked about the prospect of our finding. I think it was Edgar Cayce, talked about the uncovering of the lost Hall of Records and mm-hmm. us finding out information relating to an advanced, this fits in with Hancock's work about a super advanced civilization, predating the Egyptians, that may or may not have had an extraterrestrial influence. But the idea being that we became more advanced at a much earlier age than current recorded history or ancient history states. This is all so incredible and exciting. But I think the thing that I seize on most, the thing that I find most inspiring about this whole, your whole journey, is that it suggests that there's a version of ourselves in the future that is very keen to see us survive, make it, and evolve properly.
Their lives depend on it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Really, yeah. They got. We have to do well.
Yeah, we need to take the hint at this point. Well, that's fascinating. I mean, I know for years there was a general frustration with the Board of Antiquities. I think this was certainly how Graham Hancock stated. There was a frustration with the Board of Antiquities at the Giza Necropolis, because there was a real feeling that they were deeply insulted by the fact that anyone could dare to suggest that a people other than the Egyptians had been responsible for building the pyramids. So there was always traditionally a huge pushback from the Board of, from the Director of Antiquities there. I've been aware of numerous attempts on the Giza Plateau to use technology that was developed for the first Gulf War to scan for, that was originally developed by planes to scan, ground penetrating radar bunkers. And that they were a couple of guys with a military background that had done archaeology qualifications that were going up there to try and use this tech to try and see if they could find any unexcavated sites. And by the looks of things, there are a couple there.
If you get a chance, James, take a look at what I sent Joseph.
Yeah.
From Gary, because he's got some charts in there, some diagrams. They're brilliant, okay, and it really makes it a lot easier to understand when you start looking. You need a large screen TV to look at this stuff, though. But I really didn't understand the how important the binary was until I looked at that. Mm. I was like, oh, I'm gonna watch that again. I mean, it's like an hour and 15 minutes long, and I was like, that's the best hour and 15 minutes I ever spent, So.
Do you ever feel, Jim, looking back on all the things you've been through, do you think there is a possibility that you were selected to have this experience and to receive that message?
I think the evidence is pointing to that. Okay. It's not a by chance situation. It's all precisely thought out. I mean, as bizarre as that sounds, it's thought out. Gary and I were, we talk and we jest around a few, with stuff. And he says, Jim, he says, you ever stop and think that maybe a copy of the Rendlesham Enigma survived 8,000 years somewhere? And maybe that's why they knew when to come back?
Yes, it's entirely possible.
I mean, that's a nice thought. I mean, I was like, okay, that's a good hypothesis, but is it true? I don't know. What survives? What survives in the future? I don't know. Something, because they really have a nice roadmap, because they know exactly, from based on what's happened over the last 42 years, they know exactly when stuff's happening. So it's bizarre.
If only they could have given you the winning lottery numbers.
Yes. What's wrong with that? Yeah. I mean, really. Maybe I better go ahead and just pick two numbers from all the binary and try it.
Yeah.
Just a message like your future is in danger unless you do X, Y, and Z, and we are from the future. Hi, my name's Bob, and my friend is, that's something like that. But no, it was it's very cryptic in a way, and that's.
Then trying to. I have things I can't wrap my hands around at all on it. It's like, I mean, how can I sit there and write that down? And
I think it's strong. They've got a limited amount of time to get a message to you. So they have to get, they've selected this and this and this coordinate, said,
Well, yeah, but one of the things that bothers me on this, Joseph, is, you know, during the middle of writing that down, I got up and I was trying to find another pen. I stopped. Mm-hmm. And it still continued on where I left off. How does that work? I mean,
yeah.
I got thousands of questions.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's quite, you've never seen those type of hieroglyphs again after that? You've seen nothing on Earth? You have?
No. Yeah, they discovered some 5-10 years ago. Cerno Bruni, I guess there is a sighting in 1803. That was just recently released, I mean, last 10, 15 years, something like that. And it has the same type of writing in it that was on the side of the craft, or at least in the same family. Okay, you say, oh, they're similar. Okay. Hmm. So there were other sightings, apparently, according to that incident that happened. I think that one mainly was a USO, water type object that was recorded, but when the discovery of that really says, oh yeah, they're definitely the same family. So it seems like they have reached out, I mean, somewhere. Of course, you know, if you have the ability for interdimensional travel, time travel, I mean, for them everything could have, you know, only been done in the last week. 1803, 1980, the building of the pyramids, you know, it was all done in a week. You know, who knows for them?
Yeah.
You know, it's time is only a relative, you know, at the point in time.
It would be interesting to see these hieroglyphs, you say, that are in separate cases. That would sort of corroborate everything and tie it all together, wouldn't it?
Yeah. I think my webpage has it. I tell you what, you go to, there's a blog. If you go to the Rendlesham Forest Incident .com, that's our new blog that Darren is doing. It has those in there.
Okay.
But you can't miss it because you see Japanese or Chinese looking people, you know, so you won't miss it. But you look in, on the one side, there you say, oh, that looks like Rendlesham stuff.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So have weird things happened to you since Rendlesham? Do you think paranormal activity or anything that suggests that these things have carried on? No, has it all been pretty normal?
No, nothing has happened since or like that. One time was enough, so I'm okay with it. I've talked to people, you know, that have incidents, but there's certain people I talk to, you know, that only had, you know, the one incident, and that's one of them was the Roswell, or not Roswell, but the one that happened in Snowflake, Arizona, with the
Phoenix Lights, maybe, or
no, like. I'm not sure which one it is, his name either. I tell you what, I'm with this cold, I've got so much cold medicine in me, my memory's like
Well, you're doing gone. Fantastic to remember remember the story, so appreciate that. Actually, I wouldn't mind asking, in the book you talk about this memo that was sent to the MOD. Do you know if anything about that could be received from FOIA to, or the equivalent in the UK, to get access to that information? Is that something that we could get back?
What memo?
A memo, I think you or Holt sent a memo of the incident to.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I think that's actually, I think that's obtainable, yeah.
Yeah,
that was unclassified. He actually did it for 3rd Air Force. And I think I did a courtesy copy for the squadron. Squadron leader at Bentwaters. I think that's what they did. That's how it went to the MOD.
Okay. And do you know if there's any radar data that's available that shows the craft in the area? I think you...
There was.
Yeah.
There was. Not anymore.
Okay. Oh, okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
disappeared.
There was. Well, yeah, I mean, it's the same place my statements and everything else are, you know, they're, according to Colonel Highbush, anyway. Yeah.
There was two separate towers that showed this craft in the area. Is that right? But
well, they triangulated it because they did Heathrow radar, and then they did Eastern radar. I think that's Broad Sea. I'm not sure. I think it's RAF Broad Sea. I'm not sure. And then, of course, we had the one that was running at the base. And that's when they knew there was a bogey, you know, 15 minutes prior. And that's actually gave us the authorization that an emergency situation existed, because we lost contact with an aircraft, probably military, because it didn't have a transponder, over the base 15 minutes prior to what was going on at the East Gate. And that gave us the authorization under the Status of Forces Agreement to have an emergency situation where the base commander authorized us to deploy off base. Otherwise, you wouldn't have went off base. Everything was procedural. Yeah, everything. Yeah. I mean, it don't sound like it is, but when you explain it to you, it is all procedural. We were all doing protocols. You know, everything, we were following things by the book to a point, you know, up to the point when, you know, you couldn't follow the book anymore.
Okay. Yeah. Since the incident, has anyone reached out to you, maybe privately, from other military bases that have said anything equivalent has happened, but they've kind of not made it public?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, a lot, quite a few, actually.
Okay.
That's where, you know, it's really easy to authenticate them. You know, I mean, that's one thing about it. You can, it's easy to authenticate, you know. But for some reason, they don't. I don't care about the ridicule. You know, who cares? Mm-hmm. You know,
I think that's really dying now. I think people are waking up to this, and they are. I think there's a new level of appreciation for witnesses like yourself. And I think that we've grown up for the past 70 years, it's been laughing at people that took an interest in little green men. But I think that is now changing. And there's a real appreciation for people that can come forward and have got the strength of character to tell the story.
Yeah, and, you know, I do get some emails from the UK on sightings. You know, they say, okay, here's what I've seen. Here's what they go through it. I said, you got pictures? No. I says, that's the first thing you got to do, man. We're all carrying cell phones. You got to take pictures. Take them. And some people said, I see it again. Here's some pictures. You know, it happened. Do you know what it is? I said, no, it's a UFO. I don't know. It's unknown to me. You know, but they asked me that. But you can tell there's certain ones. And if they're, what I do is some people, and I have friends at the Lucas Labs that do the motion picture, you know, stuff. And another one at JPL, and if there's something that, you know, stands out, I'll send it to them and say, can you debunk it? You know, what is it? And 90% of the time they debunk it. They say, well, this, that, or whatever. And I'll pass that on to them. But there's also that, you know, I've had three cases, they don't know what it is. And I go, well, those are the ones that bother me, you know.
Well, that's the point with any form of report, is that even if it's only 3% or 5%, whatever it is, that's still anomalous. That's something to we got to know about. And even if the rest of it gets debunked, you know,
if you take of all the reports every year, and you say only 1% are probably unknown, that's still like 5,000 cases. That's a lot.
There's a lot out there. Yeah.
But a lot of people just don't know what the hell they're looking at. They don't know. It's even worse now with drones and stuff. They don't, you know, they'll send me stuff and that's a drone. They go, how do you know it's a drone?
That's why it's so important to recapture the cases going back to, you know, not just Rendlesham, not just Roswell, 1952 Washington incident, you know, and the Battle of Los Angeles, all these incidents in the past where It just seems to have a bit more credibility because of the problems now, as you say, with drones and CGI. And
it's unfortunate. Yeah, you know, then you get people to know how do not know how to use equipment. Mm. They think they know how to use night vision, and they're clueless. Mm. I mean, there's a reason night vision. You know, I had one person send me this orbs that were flashing, okay, at a distance. First question, do you have an airport in that direction? Wow, 12 miles away. Mm-hmm. I says, you got planes landing. I says the trees are blocking it and it makes it look like they're orbs. I says, they're not. They're, mm-hmm. Yeah. I says, if you have a match and you light it a mile away and you got a night vision goggle, that stands out. I says, you know, so even though you can't see it with a naked eye when you're looking at stuff, you got a night vision goggle, you're picking up stuff 10,000 times. I said, and so they don't know what they're doing, you know.
Yeah. I think in general, with all these mistakes being made, we're getting better at discerning and this, the information getting out there is helping people to become more vigilant and able to say, oh, that's this or that's that. This is
I agree because I know the ones from the UK are getting better. They're the ones I just don't know. I don't know the answer to them. Like,
me and James have been on a few CE5 events and we've seen a couple of things. So, you know, we've taken a video and I actually had one event where I had the camera going and then it kept turning itself off. And I heard.
Oh,
that,
really?
Yeah. I hear that that's happened before and sort of Skinwalker Ranch springs to mind. But
there's something to this communication, by the way.
Yeah.
There's something to that. I just don't know what. I can't put it, you know, I can't put it in the words. But there's, I know that there's been some really good research that's done. And then we had people are just doing it for money. Greer.
Yeah.
I mean, that guy's a fake. Okay. So, but there are people that are actually with these type of C5 type things that are actual. I had one in Wisconsin through this one person, and it's it was one of the ones I sent off to pictures I sent off to Lucas Labs, and they said, "Oh, we don't know what this is. It's not fake. You know, it's real. It's something there." They said, "We don't know how they. It's not manufactured. You know, like in a film studio." And I said, okay. And I told the person about this. And she says, I said, I think you got a legitimate C5 event there, you know. Because the person next to her didn't see nothing.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't see nothing.
That's
bizarre. And you know what? Yeah, didn't see nothing. And I says, well, I says, show him the picture. That's what you see. You know, I says, there you are.
I think trying to break it down simply, I think I've spoken to so many physicists in the past year. I think the bottom line is every time you have a thought from a basic scientific point, an electrical impulse travels down a neural pathway in your brain. Now, although chemistry and biology will have something to say about that, that's energy transference, which is governed by physics. So consciousness needs to be understood through the viewfinder of advanced theoretical physics, and we've never done any research on it. So therefore, how, you know, so what was previously classified as sort of, you know, magic is not necessarily magic, it's just science, but you need a really sophisticated understanding of this to really make sense of it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So mm-hmm. That brings me on to a question whether you, actually, I'll start the question with, do you believe in extraterrestrials? And if you do, is there a connection with the whole the consciousness thing?
I think there's probably somewhere, there's probably life somewhere else, yeah. Are they visiting us? No.
Okay.
Yeah. No, I have to see a lot more evidence from that.
But do you find yourself looking back at your own experiences now, Jim, because this, the fact that you got a download would suggest that you had some sort of, I mean, some words carry a lot of baggage. but there's no other word that I can use to describe. So you had, it would appear, some sort of telepathic exchange with this craft. Do you frame it like that in your own mind, or do you yes. Is it easier to think about it in another way?
No, I think it was definitely communication. I mean, that's you're right. Was it telepathically? Well, I guess so. I touched the craft and that activated it, or was that a circuit that I made?
Yes,
or why did it stop after I let loose? Or is that a button that transmits it? I don't know. You know, those are all good questions. I don't know. They're tough ones.
Yeah, absolutely.
But going back, we never did talk really about Kit Green, but Joseph. But with Kit, one of the things that he said that he wanted to do extensive MRIs and stuff on us is because Burroughs and I were the closest. He has done this with 50 other people.
Yeah.
And we were the closest, and he once says, apparently, you can see things, he says, this is according to Green. If you're at 50, farther away you are, say you're a mile, you are, whatever you're prone to think psychologically, wherever you have the tendency to think, if you think of, you're going to see mushrooms, or you're going to see, fairies or something like that, that's what you'll see. It's some type of it's some way for them to hide the reality of what they are. And the closer you get, the least likely this according to Green, for that to happen. And when he says, and you, Jim, he said, you were right there, we believe that for some reason you see it for what it is. That cloaking that they do otherwise, you see it for what it is. Okay, I said, whatever. And he says, well, we want to do the MRI on it. He says, because we believe, according to the other 50 people we've seen, there at least a signature in your brain that we can tell, some type of chemical signature. I said, okay. And so that was the thing that he was saying, that that's why they want to do all this research on us. Mm-hmm. And I just said to him, no, I'm not going to do that. Because I asked him, what about, why don't you just get one of the other 50? He said, well, they're not alive.
Okay.
I said, so were they the only two alive that have that been that close? And he goes, yes. And I go, oh. And I think... I don't know. I've had people contact me that say otherwise, okay, that they've had close contact, you know. So I just don't think they come forward, and I don't think that maybe that group of people know what's going on, you know, like whoever Green works for, Bigelow and them. Yeah.
So how do you think things are looking in terms of disclosure or in terms of finding out more about what is known, or what technologies are being developed behind the scenes? Do you think there's a future for us to find out?
Well, I tell you what, I understand why they'd want to know what the capability, if all these theories and conclusions that we have are true, boy, what type of power would a government a part of a government have if they had the ability to control time? Mm-hmm. What kind of power is that?
Well, it's the ultimate weapon, isn't it?
Yeah, you could do anything you want, mm-hmm. and no one would know. just rewrite it. And so and we're not even talking about the technology of some of the other aspects of it, like, you know, craft with no noise and, you know, things like that, and be able to go from make 90-degree turns at 3,000 miles an hour and all this other stuff. I mean, we're not even talking about that kind of technology, which is would be put you leaps and heads ahead of everything else, you know. So, yeah, so we're going back to that whole thing about power and control.
Mm-hmm.
That's what they want.
We discussed this. I mean, I've been quite guilty, Jim, in the past podcasts I've done with Joe of being quite vocal about this what you're describing here, which is this what type of mindset, what type of person is that narcissistic that they have to have this degree of control over the entire human race? They're making decisions unilaterally on behalf of the human race. It's really quite disturbing, and they're blocking our progress. Is there anything you think that you can see? I mean, obviously, because the encouraging thing tonight has been talking to you about the attitude of senior ranking military who were supporting you, who were encouraging you, and when you came clean about this, nobody tried to stop you, which is very, very encouraging and speaks volumes about, you know, the integrity of some of the people at a senior level. So it's clear.
Yeah, actually, James, is everybody that when I was going to go public, especially with the books, they're 100% behind us, 100%. Yeah. You go for it. That's, you know, we had those kind of conversations. Yeah. I'm behind you, you know. But for disclosure, you're not going to see disclosure like the kind that's being painted in Washington or through the UFO circuit speakers. That ain't going to happen. First of all, anything that is unclassified, like a hearing in Congress, they don't know nothing. Unclassified hearings are nothing. Because whatever, I'll tell you this much, everything that they do know is classified. And it's highly classified. And, I mean, you'd have to have hearings behind closed doors, only select people, you know. That stuff's not even happening or being thought of, okay? Open hearing on unclassified stuff is no better than going to a UFO conference, okay?
But it's just, you have to say now that classified information, keeping it behind closed doors is not going to push the human race forward. That has to come out. Otherwise, how are we ever going to get anywhere? There probably needs, are these things remaining classified to protect certain people that have been guilty of making poor decisions? Or as you said, the people that are purposely trying to keep hold of the power?
I don't know the answer to that. I think it's one of them. Yeah. You know, one of those. I suppose it's, I hate to use the term, it's about national security. I mean, I guess they, it's the same reason that we don't publicize, you know, our new high-tech hyper weapons that we have and how to build them. So other countries can, you know, we don't provide that. We keep it classified. We keep it quiet because we don't want other people to know you know, to know our capabilities. I guess that's part of it. I mean, but they use that term national security way too much, okay? Because usually you're... Usually it's not national security, okay? Yeah. It's because they want to hide what they're doing.
I think a lot of people in the community appreciate that we do need to have some degree of secrecy for national security reasons, but the degree they've used that to cover up everything has been just...
It's a crime against humanity. It's the stage where it is they've committed a crime against humanity.
I know it. We've done it often, you know. We've done it, especially since like World War II. I mean, it's horrible stuff. Even now we find out stuff that we did back then, in name of national security, was just horrible stuff. There was no reason to do stuff, you know, like that. And we find it out, you know, now looking back. I think that's the case for a lot of it. I think it's outside, you know, the military secrets. Yeah, I think you just got to have information should be shared, you know, and especially with this phenomena, you know.
Yeah. It'd be interesting to see how things pan out moving forward.
It's not going away. No. It's not going to go away.
No.
So they might as well figure out how The best way to deal, and I always find the best way to deal with stuff, just tell truth.
Yeah. It seems like there was a moment in the 50s, possibly, that things were going to come out, and then suddenly Blue Book and everything happened, and it kind of...
Yeah, but I think, one of the discussions, and I do believe this, I believe for the last 80 years, we've had nothing but a disinformation program. Mm-hmm. That's all it is. It's okay, James was talking about Little Green Man, yeah, that's part of it. They also went through it. It all started about the same time in the 40s. It's a lot of disinformation. Doesn't mean all the things that happen aren't something that needs to be investigated or weren't true. I mean, it's just that they just like with Rendlesham. I mean, the containment story, they took, they took this UFO lore and said, oh, we'll apply it here. It's just another UFO case. Well, the last thing Rendlesham is the UFO case. It has nothing to do with it. Rendlesham has to do with the binary code. It doesn't have nothing to do with me. It has nothing to do with anybody else that was there. It has to do with that binary. That's the only thing that's about. But the containment story, we see lights in the sky. We'll go ahead and spread this. Because I explained in the book how the disinformation went out, the containment story, to the pubs. And that's the best place to tell it. Go to the pub.
The Chinese whispers came from the local people. And obviously, if that had been a carefully orchestrated disinformation plan, that makes perfect sense.
Yeah, I talked to a couple that were civilian witnesses. They're coming home from a party or something. I don't know, a Christmas party or some stuff. And they told me it was disheartening because they heard all the stuff the containment story is this stuff is just, I don't know. It wasn't like that. She said, what we've seen, where it was take off, it was stop, it moved, it turned, and then gone. And it was sitting over the RC. That's what they're telling me. I go, yeah, that's what happened. Oh, so he said, okay, but that's not what we heard in the chatter that was going around the pubs. And I said, yeah, it's all disinformation. And then we had people, who weren't involved tried to be involved, and they were putting out books and stories and newspaper things. I'll tell you what, those London tabloids, they pick up on the worst things with Rendlesham. They'll pick up something and say, case solved. First of all, when they say case solved, they're lying. Okay? It ain't nothing solved. And then it come up. I mean, I've heard it all. The one about the SAS guy, the SAS guy, they said that was from London newspaper. It's solved. Well, that's all true. And, that was a pretty good article saying that it was SAS. And yes, we did have an exercise with the SAS, but that was 2 years later in July of 1982. Well, you think a newspaper would just take a little time and check out the story? Instead of just publishing it as Rendlesham solved?
Well, that's the biggest challenge is for the press all over the world now. The problem is these are commercial organizations that are trying to make money. And we all value living in a free country where you can say whatever you like. But equally, for a lot of these organizations, they are trying to sell papers, get clicks, whatever they have to do to make their dollar. And that's completely counterproductive, actually, for actually the truth coming out.
It's harmful. You're right. And that's the case. That's the case. And I tell you what, I'm pretty sure I'm not just targeting London papers. I'm talking the news media as well. I mean, it's terrible. It's all about money, I guess.
Yeah, we hopefully will see a future where a bit more transparency and coming together, all the deep polarizations, and we can start to hopefully see a better future. I think we're at a turning point right now in history where things are going. It might not seem that way right now with all the chaos in the world, but I feel like we're in that turning point maybe. Gone dark, James.
I tell you what, Joe, what's going to solve this is science, okay? The science will solve this. Mm-hmm. It's when they say, well, here's our conclusion, here's what we worked out. And it's just like with the Rendlesham case with the binary, the proof positive that Gary has done, it's the math. The math don't lie. Math is math. I mean, you can't make up numbers and try to make them work or fit a square. It doesn't work that way. So the science will actually force knowledge, the people to be knowledgeable what's going on. Sure. Disclosure, though, that they're trying to manufacture in these phony money-making ops. I mean, that's what they're talking about. They're trying to sell a paper. They're trying to sell a documentary or something like that. That's not the way to do it.
But isn't it wonderful we can sit here and establish the fact that actually the truth is far more wonderful than any of this fiction? Because what we're talking about here is one man, well, a group of men in December 1980 who had an incredible experience that were effectively given a piece of information that could help positively transform the future. That is a much more inspiring story than actually the principle that we've got, you know, flying around.
I do agree with you. Exactly. And that is the crust of it. It's the, you know what, but right from the beginning, they, you know, with the cover-up stories and all that stuff, they try to sensationalize. People try to sensationalize the event. You don't need to sensationalize. This is sensational on its own merits. I agree with you. It's, you don't have to try to sit there and make it more, I don't know.
No.
Yeah. Why do that? All you do is distort stuff, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, you've been very generous with your time, Jim. And I thought I wanted to leave on that sort of more positive note in terms of talking about, you know, the fact that this is a message about how we can get a brighter future ahead of us.
Yeah.
I think that's what, you know, Up the Vibe is about. It's about trying to think about how we can raise our vibrations and move forward in a positive manner.
I suggest, and you probably have a list of people you want to get on, but get a hold of Masters. He's just got a brand new book out that's excellent. Hancock. I mean, sure. I don't know if Graham does.
I think he's probably overbooked with their podcast.
Oh, well, I'll tell you what, Masters will get a hold of you. I mean, he's a college professor, man. He's probably a busy time of year, but I'm telling you, he's got some great ideas and thoughts and good research. Those are the kind of people that you should talk to. If someone is too busy to talk to you or something like that, there's a problem. This is not about them. It's about something much bigger. And that's why I don't understand it.
I think we're part of an important part of history right now. It's all in the making. We'll be able to look back on it and see how it all unfolded and be amazed by it all. So
maybe this podcast survives till 8,000 years.
Yeah.
Maybe that's what started this whole thing. I don't know. Exactly.
No, I would have shaved if it was going to last 8,000 years.
Oh, right. The humor.
Well, thank you very much for doing this. It's been amazing and quite insightful. And I will say again that your book is really good and really gives a good account of what happened. I'd really recommend people to read it as well, and also the Gary Osborne section afterwards where it talks about the code. Thank you very much. And
here's my plug. Amazon is where they can go ahead and buy it from, the Rendlesham Enigma. And I tell you what, if you already got like Amazon Prime or something like that, like most of us do, it's free. You can get it, the digital one, free. So
we got Christmas coming up, make a fantastic Christmas present.
It would. And I tell you, we're looking at whatever the new paper prices are out there. And we're because I want to reduce the price as low as we can get it, you know, the paperback. Right. Yeah. Well, hey, it's like 800 pages, okay? I mean, it's a thick paperback. Yeah. And let me grab it. I'm going to show you. Yeah. I don't know if you have a copy of it or not. I'll probably pull a plug or something here. This is huge.
Yeah.
I mean, good God. It's tons of information. And there's my plug for it. I tell you what, I think that's why I'm not doing a lot of podcasting anymore or going to conferences. I wrote the book. Everything I had to say is in there. At least I thought so until this is podcast.
There's always more to discover, but yeah.
But yeah, maybe I'm wrong.
Account, definitely. Yeah, and helps. And thank you, James, for
thank you
and your questions and everything. And been good.
All right. All the best to you guys. Stay healthy.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for inspiring us. Thank you, Jim. Thanks, Joe.